This is WGRG 100.5 FM, where we meet the absolute minimum FCC broadcasting standards. It's time to hang on and brace yourself for a community radio program that's frankly indescribable. Let's Talk Geneseo. Two guys with nothing better to do on a Friday morning but to talk about our community. Geneseo City Administrator Brandon Meglin and City Alderman Keith Kennett. And yeah, nobody, and I mean nobody, puts the blah in blah, blah, blah like these guys do.
Hey, and good morning, Geneseo. You're listening to WGRG 100.5 in Geneseo. And as I'm talking, I'm actually adjusting things because I'm noticing that we've been off for like a few weeks, Brandon.
Yeah.
And for some reason, we've lost a little bit of our stuff here.
It happens.
There we go. We got that and that, and I think that's a little better. I don't know what it is, actually. It's unusually warm in here, as Mark can attest to for the studio. But anyway, I digress. Again, welcome to our listeners and viewers after our three or four or five, however many weeks it's been, Brandon, since we were had scheduling conflicts.
It's kind of 3 weeks off the air.
And it's good to be back and to see you again.
You as well. Did you do anything fun during your show break?
Not really. Been spending a lot of time in Chicago the last couple of weeks. A lot of back and forth, but not necessarily fun, but that's where I've been spending most of my time.
Yeah, we were up there as well for the Illinois Municipal League Conference a couple weeks ago. That's why we were off one of the Fridays.
Well, that is correct. Well, I guess my phone wasn't working, but that's okay.
Yeah.
But anyway, we have a full show this morning, and we're going to start it off with something a little special, but I think this will start it off in a way that will be memorable.
Yes.
That's right.
You guys, listen.
After all kinds of requests.
Right. Rush 2112 Overture, everybody. I requested this as kind of my opening salvo over the last couple weeks, and Keith, to your credit, thank you very much. Fantastic.
Yeah, we couldn't pull Thunderstruck out, but we got at least we got this obscure one, and I realize this is like a 35-minute...
It really is. So yeah. I mean, I think if we played the full song, we'd be here 35 minutes later. For everybody else out there, I was kind of debating between, 2112 Overture by Rush, or maybe a little bit of Tom Sawyer, but... Excellent choice.
Yeah, well, there you go. Well, nothing says welcome to you, Mark, more than that does, and that'll be the official theme for Mark.
Yeah, I expected you to get up and dance during that. All the requests, all the times in here, you've asked Keith to put that on for you.
Maybe a little bit of an air drum in memory of Neil Peart.
There you go. Perfect. Perfect. But, Brandon, as always, we'll turn it over to you to kind of start things off this morning.
Yep. Well, as everybody just heard, that's Mark Gravicheski joining us from the Quad Cities Investment Group, our local Geneseo financial guru, back in for another show. How many is this for you, Mark? Like show 10, 11?
Boy, it's up there. Yeah. I'm not quite sure. But, again, always great to be here. I always have a good time with you and Keith. So,
Yeah. Yeah, we're also joined this morning by Brian Rothenberger of the Quad City Storm hockey team and Jenna Rushing with the State Street Market Committee. We're going to get to them here in a little bit, but we're going to start, as usual when Mark's in, with some updates on what's going on in the world and the economy. Mark, I know one of the things that we talked about, we kind of wanted to mention this morning, was that this past Tuesday, 50,000 dock workers went on strike. Across 36 shipping ports along the eastern the Gulf states. I know that, what was it, last night the strike was suspended temporarily, but what does this mean to our economy and potentially prices if the suspension doesn't last?
Yeah, a little bit of background here. You know, there were really two main sticking points between the dock workers and the port management. The first one was higher salary. The second one was the use of, technology within these shipping ports. Now, late last night, the dock workers agreed to suspend this 3-day strike by accepting a 61.5% salary increase, kind of to be spread out over the next 6 years. However, this strike is going to remain suspended until January 15th, and it kind of gives both sides a chance to try to focus on the use and adaptation of technology within the ports, and that's really where kind of been that bone of contention and that disagreement has been. So through January 15th, is kind of a cooling off period. However, both sides remain very, very far apart when it comes to the use of technology and automation within these shipping ports along the Eastern Gulf port. So we'll just kind of have to wait and see and hope for the best. But from an economic standpoint, as we kind of saw during the COVID pandemic, anytime you get a breakdown in these supply chains, it does cause a lot of economic uncertainty and impact. It's estimated that for each day that this strike is down, the economy loses about $5 billion a day in economic growth. And we kind of have to realize the importance of these shipping ports. All of these shipping ports serve as, kind of like a funnel or a conduit for finished goods and supplies and parts and raw materials that either enter or leave the country. It's good news that this strike has been suspended, and we kind of hope that they kind of iron out the remaining differences over the next couple of weeks.
Yeah. Yeah, Mark, what kind of, consumer goods are, and locally to us here in the Midwest, are impacted the most when we see these types of situations take place with the shipping from overseas?
It's really across the board. I mean, when you kind of look at some of the lessons we learned during the COVID pandemic, that whenever you do kind of get a breakdown in these supply chains, it kind of creates this inflationary environment for consumers because there are fewer goods on retail store shelves. There's fewer goods in business inventories. And all of those fewer goods, it kind of creates this upward pressure in consumer prices. And look, over the past near 4 years, American families, American households have really been struggling with high inflation. And the last thing they need is for yet another spike in consumer prices. But you really see that inflationary pressure. It's really across the board as these supply chains break down, and whether it's warehousing, whether it's shipping and transportation, whether it's at the store itself. Well, I remember, I think we all do, certain stores had to close on certain days of the week just because they either didn't have inventory or they couldn't supply the labor for it. So, I'm just kind of glad that they reached some type of tentative agreement. We'll see if that sticks come January 15th, though.
Okay. Mark, thanks as always. I know you're going to stick around and join in the conversation. You actually, I like to call you our show booker now, in a way, because about half of the guests come from Mark's brainchild of book of ideas.
Brian, I still don't get a finder's fee.
That's too bad.
Just to let you know that.
No. That is too bad.
We're working on that. But
hey, you had the opening 2112 overture. Yeah,
I mean, that's more than enough. That's good.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I've been thinking about going on strike until Keith pays me more here in the studio. But
we're going for 64%
raise.
We could go 100%. We could make it any amount because it would still be zero.
Yeah, yeah. So we're going to turn our focus now to Brian Rothenberger, President of Quad City Storm, who came all the way in from the Quad Cities with the mascot Radar, who is still in the lobby here at the Geneseo High School, who's been welcoming students this morning. We had one of the students at the high school. He won a pack of tickets, the gentleman's four tickets.
Jensen Vroman.
Jensen Vroman.
So everybody out there, Jensen is walking around the halls of Geneseo with four free tickets to the opening night game of the Quad City Storm on October 19th. So, if you get Jensen a free lunch here and there, maybe you might get in consideration for one of those free tickets.
Yeah. Good day to be a friend of Jensen.
Absolutely.
Yep.
He's the big man on campus today.
Yeah. Yeah. So, Brian, I want to get into it with you a little bit. Can you tell us a little bit about yourself, your background, and what your role is with the Quad City Storm?
Yeah, thank you all for having me on. I'm from Florida originally, was born and raised there, and my first job out of school, I was actually in broadcasting, doing sports play-by-play in North Dakota, which is a big shift from Florida, as you can probably imagine, but was there for 3 years, and I've always been a huge hockey fan. I've played hockey and just loved the sport and wanted to work in hockey, so in 2018, when the Mallards left and the storm came to the Quad Cities, there were plenty of job openings, as you might imagine, with any kind of turnover. And one of them was for a play-by-play broadcaster. So I came here, started doing that. And kind of the nature, I guess, of minor league sports is if you have a job and you do an okay job at it, you're going to get two more jobs. And that was my situation for about a year and a half before the opportunity was presented to me to become the president of the team, and kind of took that internally, and a week later the pandemic hit. So for about a year and a half after that, I was the president of pretty much myself in the business office, but it was actually a very good opportunity for me personally, because I had a year and a half to figure out what to do, because I really had no idea. Called, talked to a lot of other presidents in our league and other leagues, and learned kind of how the job worked. And then in 2021, we got the green light to start playing hockey again. So we built our staff back up, and it's been a very fun, soon to be four seasons since then.
Tell us a little bit more about, you know, obviously during the pandemic, businesses all over the United States, all over the world, kind of had some significant challenges. Being a sporting event, sporting team kind of has its own unique challenges. How did you guys kind of try to manage that?
Sure. So, you know, initially everyone was down. You know, nobody can do anything. Yeah. But as things started to very slowly open back up, you know, we have the privilege of playing at Vibrant Arena in Moline, which can seat about 9,000 people at full capacity for a hockey game. And during the build-up for the 2020-2021 season, we thought there was a chance we might be able to play as things started to open up. But in about August, we found out that starting in the new year, if we wanted to play a game, we would be able to have 50 people in the arena. So
50.
It became 50-50. And that includes players. So we were going to be able to have each team, maybe a coach.
That doesn't make for a very big wave, does
it? No, it does not. So it just became clear that we were not going to be able to play that season. So we tried to do whatever we could to keep our fans engaged. You mentioned Radar, who is out in the lobby right now. We did something we called the Radar Wave. We brought him around the Quad Cities. People could send us their address on Facebook Messenger, and we'd take Radar out to see their kids, and you know, something to kind of brighten the days during that time. You know, we did some merchandise sales, whatever we could to keep the brand out in front of people, and did what we could to not spend any money, because we had none coming in. You know, we were in the live event business. We were just not able to do anything, and just really batten down the hatches until the 2021-2022 season, when we were able to get a staff back. And that first year back, our business staff was four people. And it's not easy to put on a hockey season with four people, but we did it. And we've been fortunate, especially with our local ownership group that has been committed to allowing us to not just be back, but to grow into what the original vision was for the team, the business office, et cetera. We now have a staff of eight, which for us is huge, and are back to pretty much normal operating capacity.
Yeah. Now, outside of COVID, just normal operations, Brian, I mean, minor league teams face a lot of unique challenges. Obviously, we've seen teams come and go over the years in the Quad Cities area. Can you talk about that a little bit, and I guess what your role is in making it successful here in the Quad Cities?
Sure. So, I mean, the number one challenge, and it's similar to any business challenge, you know, what's important for us is attendance. We have to make sure people are buying tickets, make sure they're engaged in the product, so they're buying season tickets, mini plans, etc., and making sure that our product is entertaining enough to the public that they're coming, and making our corporate partners interested in being advertisers. And since we've been back from the pandemic, we have seen attendance growth every year. Our first season back, attendance was down from pre-pandemic numbers. We had about 2,300 fans a game. Last year, we averaged 3,700 fans a game, and we're probably going to be over 4,000 fans a game this season. So that's huge for us, making sure that continues. The way that happens, and really probably the biggest challenge in minor pro sports, is retention of primarily business staff. You know, we kind of break our operation up into the hockey side and the business side. And the hockey side, of course, the players who are getting into town right now, coming in from Canada, Minnesota, Belarus, Sweden, all over the place. They're here for the hockey season. We have our coaching staff, we have our equipment manager, our trainer that are some of them in full-time roles, but really doing the most of their work seasonal. Of course, coaches have to work year-round, recruiting in the off-season, exit meetings, all that stuff. But retention of that business office, you know, the same reason that I left North Dakota to come here. I wanted to kind of climb the ladder of minor pro sports and eventually one day work for a major league team. That's a lot of people's goals in minor pro sports. So, you know, I take a lot of pride in that. Last year we had a 7-person full-time front office staff, and every single one of them is back this year. In an industry that normally has almost a 50% turnover rate year to year in the front office, to have that many people back, you know, and we added a person, actually. 8 doesn't sound like a huge number, but for us it is. Being able to keep, you know, those people around that are, you know, getting more experience, becoming more familiar with the fans, the market, and just being creative with the promotional schedule we put out to keep our loyal fans, like the Romans who we saw earlier, the fans who come every game. We need to have something unique for them to get excited about, in addition to just the hockey on the ice. So being able to keep things interesting, being able to keep people, those are the two biggest challenges we face.
To kind of go off Brandon's point here, I mean, when you kind of compare, you know, minor league team to professional NHL team, obviously the budgets are a lot smaller. How do you manage the promotional side? Because when you know, local team, you look at the Chicago Blackhawks, I imagine, I don't know for sure, I would assume that budget is quite expansive when you're talking with an NHL team. How do you guys kind of overcome some of those challenges and realities of having a smaller budget, but at the same time having a promotional agenda that kind of has that outreach into the community that will draw people into into the game?
Yeah, you know, the promotional side, I think, is the one area that minor league sports people would argue that we have to work a little harder and be a little more creative than the guys at the professional level. You know, they will do bigger things than we do. They, like you mentioned, they have that budget. They also have the privilege of being able to say, you know, we're going to be rolling you know, Connor Bedard out there, and people will come just to see that. We have some players that have some name notoriety, but for us, you know, if you go to a Chicago Blackhawks game and it's country night, you could go and, you know, maybe you heard a country song, I don't know, it might have been country night, but you were at a Blackhawks game. For us, if it's Star Wars night, players are wearing Star Wars jerseys, we got Chewbacca walking around on the concourse, you know, we really lean into that, because we might get at a game with, you know, 5,000 people, we've got 1,000 people who are there for the hockey. We've got 4,000 who are coming because they want to do something. It's a Friday, Saturday night. They love Star Wars. So we spend a ton of time. I think we, even more than some other teams in our league, we are always the last ones to put out our promotional schedule, because we want to spend every minute we have to get the best, you know, post-game concerts that we might allocate some budget to. We have a Eras night for any Taylor Swift fans or families with Taylor Swift fans in them that are listening. We've got a Taylor Swift cover band coming down from Chicago to play before the game. We've got our standards, our salute to military night, where we just get the best of those promotions we've done year to year that we know people want to come back to, while adding some things to keep it fresh. Just really getting creative and getting input from our entire staff. You know, I've been here since the team started. I have my ideas of what works. People who have been here for 2 years, they might have fresh ideas that are way better than some of the ones I have, and that's great. So it's that collective input and creativity that I think really puts that promotional schedule to the next level.
Yeah, but before we kind of move on here, I definitely want to give you a chance to kind of explain to the audience, or promote to the audience, maybe some of the family-friendly events and how to get tickets, because obviously the opening season is October 19th.
You are correct. Yeah, it's coming up very quickly. I think It is 2 weeks from now that we will have our opening night versus Peoria, which for anyone who's been to our games versus Peoria, you know, is always a spirited affair when we face those guys. We have so many games, like I mentioned, on the promotional schedule. We have our second game, home game of the season, is a Beetlejuice night. Our schedule ranges from late October to early April, primarily Fridays and Saturdays, and you can go to QuadCityStorm.com to print off one of those promotional schedules. We have a special new offer just for families, actually, this season. It's called our Framway Plan for Saturday games. You get four tickets, four hot dogs, four drinks, all for just about $100. That's available on our website. So great ways to get the whole family out. Tickets start at $13. It's an affordable entertainment option, and it's going to be here very soon.
Well, thank you so much for being here today, Brian.
Absolutely. Yeah. Thanks for having me.
Yeah. Thanks, Brian.
Yeah, and we appreciate, again, you bringing Radar as well, who is greeting the students as they come into the high school. And I can attest, nothing more fun than a Storm game. A very pet-friendly situation, too, in that they have, I believe you still have, like, pet nights and different things that you can do, bring the dog and enjoy the game type thing.
Yes, Sunday, January 5th is our Bucks and Paws Day on the schedule. It's also Margaritaville Day. Oh. But, yeah, it's a 2 o'clock start on a Sunday. Bring the dogs to the game. It's a good way to get them out of the house in the winter. And, yeah, those games are – it's funny to be sitting watching hockey and just hear barking all of a sudden. It's a very unique experience.
It definitely is. Can attest to that. So, again, Brian, again, thank you for taking the time to come out and share the story of the Quad City Storm with us.
Absolutely.
Thanks, Brian. All right, we're going to turn our attention now to Jenna Rushing. Jenna is with Hanford Insurance, and she also serves on the Chamber Board of Directors and the State Street Market Committee, amongst other things, I'm sure. So welcome, Jenna.
Thank you. Thank you.
So give us a little bit about yourself and your history here in Geneseo and what brought you on to the Chamber and being involved in all these things.
Sure, sure. So Jenna Rushing and I grew up here in Geneseo, born and raised. Went away to college, worked in Des Moines for a couple of years, but was excited to come back and work with a family business. Early this year, I joined the Chamber. And I was eager to help with the State Street Market. It's one of my favorite events that we have here in Geneseo. I think I saw that this is the 9th year, so hope to get it bigger and better every year.
Yeah, and this is coming up tomorrow. Excuse me. I think you could say it's one of, behind the Christmas Walk celebration, you know, this is really becoming one of the top chamber events and events for Geneseo in general for tourism to come in and people to visit and see our town, spend some money and have a fun day, right? So this is tomorrow. So can you walk us through, I guess, what's the overall picture of this? Where is it taking place? What time does it start? What kind of things can people expect?
Sure. I'm glad I brought my notes, Brandon.
brought a book.
I did bring a book. This is downtown. This is primarily going straight down downtown on State Street. Roads will be closed from Exchange Street to 2nd Street. We have over 50 vendors. They come all the way from Iowa, the Chicago suburbs, a lot of returning favorites, and then we're excited to welcome some new vendors here this year. It starts at 10 a.m., and it will go until 5 p.m. We do have a couple live music artists coming. One is Angela Meyer. In the afternoon, it is Bobby Ray Bunch. So
nice.
Lot of food. I think we have about 6 or 7 food trucks coming, but our downtown restaurants are ready to serve as well. So
awesome. Awesome. So where should people park for this? I think there's a trolley, right?
There is a trolley. The trolley will be picked guests up at the Moose and dropping them off at the old library parking lot. There's also parking just anywhere you can find it around downtown. Parking lots behind the buildings on State Street.
Yeah, there are some disruptions this year. We have a couple of big construction water projects going on the north side of State Street, as well as Oakwood Avenue. So you're probably going to want to avoid North Oakwood. I would come in from the south, take advantage of that trolley, and may want to stay clear of the fire department area as well on North Street. So what kind of vendors are you most excited about? What are some of your, you guys sit in these committee meetings for months, I know, planning and curating a list of people who can come to the market. And, I mean, you guys turn away a lot of applications, right, just because of the space that's available. But
yes.
A lot of people want to be here for this.
Yes, yes. There is, I will be visiting every single booth this year. I don't know if I can name a favorite. A lot of apparel, women's apparel, a lot of jewelry, clay earrings, home decor, and just cowboy boots. I know a lot of big fans of No Roots Boots, and she will be returning. So there's something for everyone, definitely.
Excellent. Yep. Be sure to check out food vendors and our local restaurants to mm-hmm. have lunch on Oakwood in the Interstate District or downtown at one of our restaurants before you visit the market. Yeah. Keith, you going to be there?
I'll be there. That's for sure. It's going to be a beautiful day for it. So, yeah. What else would you want to do other than spend a nice late morning, early afternoon in Geneseo?
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Well, thanks for joining us, Jenna. That's all I've got today. Keith, do you have any other updates or anything else we want to get into?
I was going to ask you. You know, we really haven't talked in weeks and stuff. So anything new city-wise and stuff? We talked a little bit about the construction, the ongoing construction. Maybe we could touch on that a bit on status of those projects.
Yep. So the North State Street project, full infrastructure going in, stormwater, sewer, new streetscape, sidewalk, lighting. Phase one of that project is underway. We know it's a large inconvenience from Park, where it starts right now, heading up north. Eventually, we'll stretch all the way to Ogden up here to the high school. But that first phase that's going on from Park to Palace Row right now is still on schedule to wrap up by December 1st. We're going to have a break in the project over the winter months. Don't want to keep that all closed when snow's flying and they can't really do a lot of the work anyway. So we will end phase one. They're on track. It may actually be a little bit early. We had a meeting this week that storm installation is wrapping up, and we're going to see concrete streets start going in there by the end of the month. So that's very good news and on track for the December 1st wrap-up.
And one of the reasons that we broke that up into three segments is that we're recognizing that's a big inconvenience for the homeowners and stuff as this is going on. So we wanted to make sure that it was finished up before winter set in so that we didn't have a full winter of just mud and yuck and all that sort of stuff. So anyways, moving on, it'll be nice when it's done, but also a lot, like you say, going on around the fire station area.
Yep. That's a water main infrastructure replacement project and service replacement project. Now they've turned onto North Street heading east from the intersection of Oakwood and North. The contractor there is installing new water main services to the home, which will head all the way down north to Chicago Street, and that project is also on schedule. Some minor inconveniences there. We see Oakwood torn up in front of City Hall and the fire station right now. It was recently milled, but next week that's all going to be repaved, and we're going to have a nice, smooth street surface there on 2nd and the Oakwood area, too. It's been bumpy for a while. There's been a lot of water projects there. Mm-hmm. So excited about that streetscape going back in for a final time.
And what on earth is going on with North? A lot of, by the community center and what have you, if you drive down North Street, you notice a lot of digging going on.
Yeah. So that's part of that same project, Oakwood by the fire station. They redid a full water main there. And then now that we've turned on to North heading east from the fire station area, heading down north, they're actually just replacing the water service mains going to homes. That's part of a connection to a larger main that was put in some years ago. All the services are being replaced. That'll help with water quality, water flow, things of that nature. So looking forward to that.
All right. Well, all good. And I know Brian, who is still here, is particularly enjoying our unique ambiance here in the radio station, where we compete with the student announcements and that soundtrack. Probably something you haven't experienced in your broadcasting career. I'm going out on a limb there, Brian.
No, but I like it. It's organic, and it works.
There you go.
It works.
You couldn't replicate this if you tried.
No.
Got to block it out.
There you go. All right. Well, with that, we're going to wrap it up. I think Brandon has some sort of a floor hockey game scheduled with Radar in the main hallway after this. So may want to check that out.
Get my skates out.
Perfect. Yeah. All right. Well, again, we appreciate everybody coming in this morning. Mark, Brian, Jenna, Brandon, always good seeing you. And so are we back? Are we back next
week?
We're
back. I think we're going to run this thing out until the holidays. So
yeah. I was kind of liking the one show on, four shows off, or whatever we were doing. That was working pretty good, but I guess it's back to reality.
Yeah, back to a consistent schedule.
There you go. Okay, well, thanks everyone also for listening or viewing. And this has been Let's Talk Geneseo on WGRG 100.5 FM in Geneseo. Have a great weekend.